One more person to thank Filippo for inviting him, for the invitation to come all this way to the other side of campus to speak. And for reasons I won't go into, this paper that I'm about to give has already been published. I have copies here if anyone wants a copy at the end of the session. And what it also means is that you can't find anything wrong with the paper because it's already been published, right? So it has to be just right. Okay, so on 25th of February 2002, Rafael Perez, a former member of the Los Angeles Police Department, appeared accused of various crimes, covering up a bank robbery, shooting and framing an innocent citizen, stealing and selling cocaine from evidence lockers, being a member of a Los Angeles gang called the Bloods, and even murdering the rapper, the notorious B.I.G. This obviously is taking police work a little bit too far, perhaps, but in his statement to the court, he pointed out that above the doors to the offices of the Los Angeles Police Department, there are various philosophical mottos. It's, for example, some rise by sin and some by virtue fall, or we intimidate those who intimidate others. And Perez commented, "To those mottos, I offer this. Whoever chases monsters should see to it that in the process he does not become a monster himself." Now, the quote from Nietzsche might appear unusual coming from the mouth of a former police officer, but it's in fact far from uncommon. So, "Whoever Fights Monsters" is the title of one police memoir, in which Nietzsche's aphorism also appears as an epigraph. And the appearance of the aphorism is a reflection of the extent to which police discourse is saturated with ideas about catching monsters, fighting monsters, or mediating between monsters and men. So what I want to suggest here is that we might want to consider the relationship between the monster and the police. If we take as our starting point the fictional monster that appears in the TV series Dexter. Now this series, enough of you know about the series, but the series is essentially about what might be called a kind of ethical serial killer, a killer who kills people who deserves to be killed. Now, the main character, Dexter, had a traumatic experience at an early age when he sees his mother brutally killed by a gang of drug dealers with a chainsaw. And this bloody murder haunts him to the point where he's obsessed by blood, which gets turned into a positive, so to speak, by focusing his anger on people who deserve to die, essentially murderers and rapists who have somehow escaped the criminal law and who are thus walking free. Not only does Dexter kill people, but he does so in a brutal and bloody way, chopping them up and disposing of their bodies in the sea. Now, the first thing to note about Dexter is that he's framed by the series as some kind of monster. Quote, "I know I'm a monster," he says to one character just as he's about to kill them. Likewise, when Dexter's partner Rita comments on the existence of the Bay Harbor Butcher, a serial killer who turns out to be Dexter himself, she says that it makes her angry that there's a monster out there. But in Dexter's voiceovers, the series is done through a series of voiceovers, he constantly clarifies his own monstrosity. He reminds us that, quote, "monsters come in all shapes and sizes," and will often kind of finesse observations made by others. "I'm not the monster he wants me to be," he says in relation to one conversation. This comes up time and again. Now, Dexter's monstrosity is also articulated through the kind of primal moment of his second birth, namely the time when he witnesses the bloody murder of his mother. So in series one, he revisits the place of her murder and he comments that, quote, "something nameless was born here," which is an allusion to Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, in which the monster itself has no name. And this Frankenstein theme continues throughout, such as when his adoptive father says that the doctors who treated Dexter, quote, "didn't even see the monster inside." And in one series, his lover Lila says to him, "you make a monster of yourself." So Dexter is framed by the series as a monster. Left at that, there isn't really much to concern us, right? There's another serial killer, another media construction in which writers play on the fact that we use monstrous to describe those creatures who kind of defy moral codes and kill, another kind of, if you like, inhuman human. However, one of the reasons Dexter can be so successful a serial killer, and thus a monster, is because he works for the forensic team of Miami Metro, specializing as a blood analyst. In other words, Dexter works within the police. He's not a police officer per se, though often masquerades as one, but like many serial killers, he has a place within the general system of police power. Indeed, the fact that he's not a uniformed police officer as such, alerts us to the wider concept of police power which I'm using. So Dexter is a monster born into the police power. Right? His adoptive father was a police officer, and the fact that he is a very neat monster, as he keeps reminding us, comes in the form of aping or copying police practice. Blood slides, cataloguing, the perfectly organized set of weapons. When he goes about his killings, he enacts the key aspects of the police procedural: investigation of a suspect, establishing the suspect's motive, finding clues, establishing guilt, hunting, capturing, questioning, executing. All of which is to say that what's interesting about Dexter is that he is not somehow stepping in to enforce some kind of natural law of justice or punishment, which is how the kind of cultural studies industry reads Dexter, right? The cultural studies readings of Dexter treat him as kind of our monster, right? I don't think that's what's going on. Rather, the point, I think, is that his whole modus operandi is a systematization of the police enterprise, right? He fights monsters, but he has also become one, right? He's a monster within the police power. So the series Dexter, I want to suggest, is a reminder of an intimate and abiding connection between the monster and the police. Now, it's remarkable, I think, how frequently this connection between the monster and the police is overlooked in more general discussions about the power of the monstrous. And what I want to suggest is that we cannot really grasp the idea of the monstrous, the power of the monstrous, without simultaneously considering the idea of police. So the common refrains about the monstrous tend to discuss its power in terms of the way things like communities are ordered, subjectivities are constituted, identities are bounded, societies are bordered, and so on. Right? That monsters define the limits of civilization, they're deeply connected to insecurity, they indicate some kind of breakdown of hierarchy, and they point to a certain kind of unruliness of matter. What is often overlooked in such claims is that these issues are the very same issues that underpin the whole police problematic. So I want to suggest that to grasp the power of the monstrous, we might need to consider it in terms of the ubiquity of the police idea in modernity. In a discussion about his actions, the exact actions he engages in with Hannah, one of his lovers, in the final series, Dexter tries to explain himself. Now, he speaks the language not of justice, not of revenge, not of punishment, not even of law, but uses a particular phrase to describe his work, right? His work of killing people and disposing of their bodies. He says, "I'm taking out the trash," right? And this is a phrase he uses several times to describe the disposal of the body of someone he's killed and who we are expected to believe deserved to be killed. Now, this description of his own monstrous behavior is obviously meant to reinforce his monstrosity, right? He's so kind of inhuman that he can regard killing and disposing of other people, other human beings, as taking out the trash. But taking out the trash, and in general terms, cleaning up, are familiar tropes among serial killers, right? So Peter Sutcliffe, a famous English serial killer. We've introduced some of you to English timekeeping for the conference, and so now I'm going to introduce you to an English serial killer. Peter Sutcliffe, a famous English serial killer from the 1970s, known as the Yorkshire Ripper, commented, I was just cleaning up the streets, right? Just cleaning up the streets. And the nickname he gave to himself wasn't the Yorkshire Ripper, the nickname he gave to himself was the street cleaner. Right? This is an incredibly common theme amongst serial killers. But we should also note that the idea of cleaning the streets and disposing of garbage resonates through modern police discourse. Study after study has shown the extent to which the police regard themselves as, quote, in the words of one officer, a mandate to keep the streets clean. And ethnographies of police officers often comment on the extent to which police officers refer to their work as, in one voice, refuse collectors, sweeping up the human dross. So the clearing up of crimes is deeply connected with the cleaning up of streets. And this is why the same ethnographies of police officers constantly note that the police themselves routinely speak of members of the criminal, dangerous and miserable classes as variously social dirt, slag, pollution, scum, refuse, waste, garbage. So the police then regard themselves as, again, quote, a kind of uniformed garbage men, in the words of one officer, just like the monstrous serial killer, but dressed, of course, in the robes of the state. Now, the easy interpretation here is to say that this is just about disrespect, right? This is about the police not kind of learning respect and not being properly democratic. A longer historical view suggests something else. When modern police officers speak about cleaning up the moral filth and social dirt, they are unknowingly holding on to and yet also twisting one of the original powers of police, namely in street cleaning and refuse collection. Police once had the responsibility of it to ensure that the streets were clean, and virtually all the police theorists of the 17th and 18th century, from the low-ranking cameralists and police scientists to the high-ranking philosophers of state, listed garbage collection as one of the police functions. And the reason they did so was because dirt and its associated matters such as rubbish is an offence against order. So it's not lack of cleanliness itself that's the problem, but the fact that the lack of cleanliness undermines good order. Dexter says, "I enjoy my work. It brings order to the chaos." And his comment applies to his work as in the police power, but also as a serial killer. So the removal of the dirt and the taking out of the trash is the reimposition of order, a replacement of matter into an ordered system. So from Dexter's reference to taking out the trash, we very quickly arrived at the central category of police power: order. Right? From the late 15th century, the concept of police denoted the legislative and administrative regulation of the internal life of a community to promote general welfare and the condition of good order. And this idea behind this was encapsulated in phrases such as, this is in the discourse of police theory, right? Police and good order, good police and order, the well-ordered police state. And the instructions and activities considered necessary for good order, known as police ordinances, and referred to the management and direction of the population by the state. And this is evident in the kind of the heterogeneous range of affairs and minutiae of social life that came under the police power, right? From public security to public health, right? Long tradition of medical police, which we now call the welfare system or the health system, right? From poor relief to food adulteration, the maintenance of roads, bridges, and town buildings, to expenses at christenings and weddings and funerals, from the performance of trades and occupations to the wearing of extravagant clothing, from morals and manners to the behaviour of servants towards their masters, and of course, street cleaning and garbage collection. This is why the police texts concern themselves with the general and common good of society. In other words, as a kind of political administration in general, police is nothing less than the fabrication of social order. Now, I'm making these points for reasons that are probably clear to any of you thinking about the power of the monstrous, but to spell it out, all of the key issues that occur in debates about monstrosity, right? Issues such as insecurity and community, hierarchy and rule, class and power, subjectivity and identity, borders and boundaries, all of those point to the problem of disorder posed by the monster. Yet one cannot talk about order without talking about the fact that order is the fundamental police problem. Now, this is partly why the criminal has played such a central role in the study of monstrosity. This is a point Foucault makes clear, I think. The penal justice system that was developed and refined with the consolidation of the bourgeois state would find monster after monster within the social body, a figure who had kind of fallen outside of the social pact and is thereby associated with a possible criminality. Foucault comments that, quote, "The criminal designated as the enemy of all, whom it is in the interest of all to track down, falls outside the pact, disqualifies himself as a citizen, and emerges bearing within himself, as it were, a wild fragment of nature. And this creature appears as a villain, or monster, or madman. Every criminal could well be a monster," Foucault says, "just as previously it was possible that every monster was a criminal." And Pasquale Pasquino extends this argument by suggesting that it's around the figure of that kind of homo criminalis that criminology will emerge, but the ancestor of homo criminalis is the monster. And this, the role of the serial killer as our archetypal social monster plays heavily on this connection, as in a sense the references to Dexter suggest. But this focus on the way that the individual who commits crimes comes to be regarded as monstrous is somehow not enough. Why? Because it treats monstrosity as a challenge to law, right? That's a title from a book on Foucault and monsters, right? Challenge to Law, Andrew Sharp's book. When in fact the basis of the original juridico-natural frame of reference of the monster was order rather than law. So the problem we have is that the twinning of law and order in the commonplace law and order masks the fact that from the police perspective, order is the key concept. Conversely, police does not equal law. So looked at politically then, we need to read the police power through the lens of order rather than law. But then this might mean that looked at in terms of disorder, we need to read the power of the monstrous through the lens of police. And it's the difficulty in categorizing the monster in the kind of order of things that makes the monster represent something far more challenging to the bourgeois imagination than mere illegality, right? What the monster offers is disorder. In the series of lectures published as Abnormal, Foucault suggests that although every criminal could well be a monster, first among these as a threat is the political criminal, the one who breaks the social pact by being, the one who breaks the social pact and who, by being against society, is seemingly against nature. Foucault points out that although the political monster might in fact be the king or queen, there is also the monster that breaks the social pact by revolt. This is the monster from below to match the monster from above. And Foucault places it at the heart of the question of monstrosity. And if we accept the revolt of the monster from below as more significant both politically and historically, as I think we must, right, for political reasons, then it's also surely the case that the revolt of this monster is at the heart of the police problem. Now, we might consider this in the light of the thinker who most obviously placed the concept of order at the heart of state power, who did so through an articulation of the problematic of security, and who did both of these things by organizing his work around the famous monsters of Leviathan and Behemoth, right? So we're back on Hobbes, just in case you thought Hobbes, we'd finished with Hobbes for 2 days. Oh no, no, no. All roads lead to Hobbes here, right? So to title works with the name of two biblical monsters was truly provocative, as Hobbes knew full well. Not for nothing did Hobbes earn himself the nickname, the Monster of Malmesbury. But what do they mean, and why might they help us grasp the monster with the police? The biblical creature Behemoth appears in the Bible in the book of Job, just prior to the appearance of the beast called the Leviathan, which Hobbes had used to symbolize the stately creation which brings peace, security, and order. Now, interpretations of Hobbes' use of Behemoth for this title of his book vary, but the dominant one is that Hobbes chooses Behemoth, seeming to think that the civil dissensions of the people might be justly compared to the wild and formidable motions of an enormous animal. Although Hobbes seems to be referring to the Long Parliament, the Behemoth comes to symbolise more generally the, quote, circular motion of the sovereign power between two usurpers. The two usurpers in question, I think, appear to be the disorderly anarchy of revolution and the lawlessness of rebellion. Now, set against the Behemoth is Leviathan, and whatever the two creatures are meant to signify, they are conceived of both as antagonists and as elemental opposites. More to the point, whatever the two creatures are meant to signify, it's clear that Hobbes employed the monstrous Leviathan as a symbol for the state of peace, security, and order, and the monstrous Behemoth as a symbol for the state of civil war, rebellion, and disorder, and offers the former as the only alternative to the latter. It would appear that one monster, an enormous security system known as the Leviathan state, exists in order to continuously hold down another monster, the revolutionary people understood as the Behemoth. Stephen Holmes puts it succinctly in his introduction to one of the editions of Behemoth, it takes one monster to subdue another. Yet, this does not quite tell the whole story. David Williams notes in his book, Deformed Discourse, notes that Leviathan is the marine representative of a group of monsters whose chief significance is their devouring activity. The Leviathan swallows its victims whole, but does not destroy them. The victims go through the process of being devoured, but without in fact being annihilated. Now, this devouring points us to the image used as the frontispiece of Leviathan that you talked about earlier, right? Amy talked about earlier, right? The idea, you used the phrase, the Leviathan is filled with the people, yeah? Okay. So the sovereign kind of incorporates his subjects by somehow devouring. And in this context, we're immediately reminded of a number of things. We're reminded of the importance of the of the belly to the body politic. Right, Hobbes's employer, one-time employer, Francis Bacon, had commented in his essay, notably on sedition, that, quote, rebellions of the belly are the worst. And Hobbes's Leviathan has to deal with a range of problems, such as worms, right, which are too many corporations, intestine disorder, which are errors made when instituting a commonwealth, and bulimia, right, which includes dominion, which includes enlarging dominion. We might also be reminded that in the Philosophical Rudiments Concerning Government and Society, published the same year as Leviathan, Hobbes has suggested that, quote, all kings are to be reckoned among ravenous beasts. Whatever we're reminded of, the point is that it's not so much that one monster holds down or subdues another, but that one monster devours another and preserves it inside the belly of the beast. Quote, here I am, in the belly of the beast, says Dexter, one day in the office of Miami Metro. And it's a phrase that's used time and again by politically astute prisoners as a sign of their fight against, inside and against, the kind of whale-like Leviathan state that devours them, right? So, for example, the Red Army faction, as a recognition of their what they understood as their imprisonment within the belly of the beast, right, gave themselves a nicknames from Moby Dick, right, as a kind of sense of that being that inside. So the first point to note is that the police power instituted with the modern state might be thought of as a power to devour one and all, everything it encounters, including other monsters, subsuming them within its own force and keeping them within its security frame. The monster from below is also the monster within. But this does also not quite tell the whole story. The reference to the monstrous Leviathan might appear to preempt a reference to Nietzsche's suggestion that the state is the coldest of all monsters. As Andrea noted, someone noted earlier, right? But as Nietzsche adds, the state also lies about this. That wasn't noted earlier. And the lie that creeps from its mouth is, quote, I, the state, am the people, end quote. And if there's one thing that the people does not wish to imagine itself as, it's monstrous. Indeed, if Job's suffering in the book of Job and his insecurity and fear as a whole is meant by Hobbes to refer more or less to the condition of man in the state of nature, and if the implication is that this condition is overcome only by submission to the new mighty sovereign, then any monstrous features of this new order really have to be hidden away. So the state's emergence alongside civil society and the people, and the state's policing of civil society and the people, in the name of order and security, requires that the state appears to be above not only the beastly condition of the state of nature, but also somehow above all forms of monstrosity. So any hint of the state's own monstrosity has to disappear from view. So far does the state's monstrosity disappear from view that in Hobbes's account, the monstrosity in question is barely hinted at in the first place. So the Leviathan makes four appearances in Hobbes's text, right? In the introduction, in which it's understood as a huge artificial man, a huge artificial animal, and a huge machine. In chapter 17, where it's described as a mortal god. In chapter 28, where it's referred to in the discussion of the chapter in Job. And as an image on the frontispiece, which shows a huge person. Now, in none of these appearances is the key feature, the monstrosity, right? Rather, its key feature is its power, as we talked about earlier. Upon earth, there is nothing compared with his power. A power to achieve, and this is what you point you made, nothing less than the joining of men in society, in terms of the Hebrew Leviathan, yeah? But the point is, this is an ordered society. In other words, the point of the Leviathan is to appear not as an omnipotent monster, but as the omnipotent technology of an organizing power. A machine, an organic being, a mortal god, ultimately it doesn't really matter which of these forms the state takes, since what matters is that any hint of the monstrosity is replaced by the far more neutral and far less threatening science of governing men. The use of Leviathan as the title of the book may well have been designed as a provocation, and no doubt Hobbes believed that his readers would quickly grasp the allusion to the biblical monster, but the hint of the monstrosity of Leviathan only serves to reveal the emergence of absolute authority as a technology of power for preserving the peace. The abiding concern of Hobbes at the end of the day, right, which is this abiding concern is the problem of order, presented by Leviathan as an omnipotent technology exercised in the name of security, which is, of course, as Marx points out, the supreme concept of bourgeois society. And as Marx also then says, the concept of police. Hobbes's account of the creation of the Leviathan rests heavily on the perpetual war of the state of nature within which the fear and insecurity, the danger and disorder will push people to seek the protection of the sovereign. But the transition from the state of war to submission to the Leviathan leaves open the possibility that the war continues in the form of some kind of internal rebellion. Continues, that is, in the form of revolutionary movements within the body politic, inside the belly of the beast. So the fundamental fear and insecurity which permeates the perpetual war of the state of nature is assumed to also exist in the condition of rebellion and revolt, which Hobbes says are but war renewed. The sovereign is expected to offer security and protection from all such fears in exchange for the obedience. So what is conjured up is, as Derrida puts it, an insurance policy, right? A police d'assurance, which basically entrusts to sovereignty the very powers of security and protection that will be called police. So if we now read the fear of rebellion and civil war as a fear of the behemoth, then what is being offered is in fact security from the monster. And the dialectical relationship that Derrida reads between the beast and the sovereign, which we've talked about a bit today, right, might thus be reconsidered as a relationship between the monster and the police. The security offered by the state displaces the monstrosity of the state and is turned towards the monstrosity of disorder. So the monstrousness of Leviathan is no longer the issue, for the state instead becomes a police operation against the monstrous behemoth. This is why it's more important to keep in sight the monstrosity of the behemoth rather than the Leviathan. That's why I asked that question earlier about what happened to behemoth, right? Why are we talking about Leviathan? Behemoth, this is a point you touched on, is the Hebrew plural form of a word meaning beast, but also signifies an aggregation of monsters. Behemoth is a plurality of forces and thus, in a sense, the beastly and multifaceted multitude. So to keep the behemoth in sight is thus to hold on to the observation that in being devoured by the Leviathan, the behemoth continues to exist inside the police power as a kind of permanent enemy within. It's also to keep in sight the fact that as rebellion or revolution or civil war or disorder, behemoth is a monster with many heads. Now, in their book, The Many-Headed Hydra, Peter Linebauer and Marcus Rediker argue that the merchants, manufacturers, planters and officials of the dominant European states found in the multi-headed monster a key motif for the rebellious disorder of the lower classes. This motif worked alongside the understanding of the figure of Hercules. Right? Hercules was regarded as unifier of the territorial state by the Greeks, signified imperial ambition to the Romans, and was associated in general with a vast labour of the fabrication of order, draining swamps, developing agriculture, securing commerce, and even doing the cleaning up. The specific monster that Hercules was meant to tame or destroy was the many-headed hydra of Lerna. As Hobbes puts it, dealing with subjects is a task, quote, like that of Hercules with the monster hydra, with which, having many heads, for everyone that was vanquished, there grew up three. Now, Linebauer and Rediker show just how far the many-headed hydra was understood in terms of the rebellious and dangerous classes, right? So food rioters, heretics, army agitators, antinomians, independent women, motley urban mobs, strikers, aquatic laborers, free thinkers, striking textile workers, peasant rebels, levelers, pirates, and slave insurrectionists were all, at some point, described as needing a Herculean task of being destroyed, this multi-headed monster. Now, it's in this context that we need to keep in sight the monstrosity of the behemoth. Now, in Hobbes' book, Behemoth, one part of the dialogue runs as follows. B, says the two characters, right, A and B. B, quote, "You have read that when Hercules fighting with the Hydra had cut off any one of his many heads, there still arose two other heads in its place, and yet at last he cut them off all." A says, "The story is told false, for Hercules at first did not cut off those heads, but bought them off. And afterwards, when he saw it did him no good, then he cut them off and got the victory." I'm going to come back to that word got in just a moment, right? The Herculean task of the capitalist ruling class has been to construct a new bourgeois order. And the myth of the many-headed hydra simultaneously expressed the fear and justified the violence of the ruling class in carrying out this task. Building such order and exercising violence against any force obstructing that process is the definition of police power. It is to conduct this Herculean task that Leviathan exists, a political machine of and for security and a political body of and for police to defeat the multi-headed enemy. Yet, the problem for the ruling class is that this struggle is never really over, right? The victory is never really got, as Hobbes puts it, because despite buying off or cutting off the various heads as they appear, the monster always lies within the body politic. This is why police discourse from the 16th century to the present has never stopped talking of the permanent wars being fought against the enemy within, right? The disorderly, unruly, criminal, indecent, disobedient, disloyal, lawless, and mindless, each of which kind of morphs into the other, constantly changing shape in monstrous fashion, lining up with or brushing alongside the killer, the regicide, and the terrorist, and even performing the filthy trick of appearing to be human. This multi-headed hydra is a creature the ruling class fears will devour it, and so the creature itself must be devoured, an uncontainable creature which must nevertheless somehow be contained. Now, the need for the creature to be contained is why the concept of keeping is so important in Leviathan, right? The keep, right? This bit here, right? The castle, the stronghold of the castle is known as the keep, right? Or was the keep historically, right? And keeping as a theme runs through the whole of Leviathan, right? Hobbes talks about keeping the subjects in obedience, keeping them from discontent, keeping them quiet, keeping them from rebellion, keeping them in space, keeping them in order, and keeping them in awe. All rolled into that core keeping, right? The core keeping, which turns out nonetheless to be the core principle of the whole history of police theory, keeping the peace. Leviathan is the police power of containment, keeping, there it is again, keeping us safe and secure from our monsters, ourselves. In the final episode of the final series of Dexter, there is a flashback scene to the moment of the birth of Dexter's son. Dexter is worrying about whether he will make a good father, and Deb, his sister, assures him that he will. Quote, she says, "You've always taken care of me, especially when we were young. You made me feel so fucking safe." She swears a lot, right? That's one of her themes. In particular, she reminds him of her greatest fear during the night. Quote, "Don't you remember the monsters?" she asks, and then reminds him that he made her feel secure by explaining that the monsters were just the shadows. And Deb's suggestion that Dexter protected her from the monsters is immediately undermined by Dexter's own voiceover. "You were so wrong, Deb," he says in the voiceover. Wrong because there really are monsters and Dexter is one of them? Perhaps, but maybe she was right in that this monster nonetheless did protect her and keep her safe and secure, because this monster had more than a touch of the police power. Security and protection are two of the most fundamental mechanisms which underpin the police power. But in security, there is always insecurity. And in protection, there is always fear. Let's face it, you never feel entirely secure when there's a police officer around. One of the functions of the power of the monstrous is that it is crucial to the political construction of fear and insecurity. Circulating around and operating through the fears and insecurities of bourgeois modernity, the monster and the police come together. With the continual iteration of issues concerning order and disorder, security and identity, borders and boundaries, containment and excess, the discourses of monstrosity and police share a fundamental conceptual ground, a problem to be contained and a process of containment. Now, it's for this reason that all of the main themes in the discourse of monstrosity point to the police problematic, I think. The final episode of Dexter is called "Remember the Monsters?" By all means, let us remember the monsters, as we're doing here, right, over 2 days. But never forget that as much as modernity gives us the monsters, it also gives us the police. Thanks for listening.
Many thanks for this presentation. will be many questions. And who will start?
Pubs are open.
I'm to go first. Fantastic. There's something that's kind of bored in a way, but also I feel
kind of what did you
bored? But also I think quite important maybe to think, namely the invisibility of the monster and how you have to take the monster out of sight. And I think that actually that may be constituting its monstrosity ultimately, potentially its uncanniness. And I think that Leviathan is such nowhere. Where is it? Where is it in this building? Is it in the one body of the king? In the other? Where is it? It's nowhere. We have all these bodies, but actually it's invisible. It's nowhere. It's intangible. And I think in a way you have to hide the monster, but on the other hand it's already hidden. It's already nowhere. It's already and the fact that it's all nowhere but also everywhere. I think this is a dimension of this monstrosity.
That's an interesting thought. I mean, I don't think the trouble is it's not that it's nowhere, it's that it sometimes appears to be nowhere. In the sense that I'm going to use concepts that Walter Benjamin uses when he talks about police power, in the sense, because I think he makes an important point that kind of you are getting to eventually, right? It appears nowhere in that it's intangible, often, not always, but often appears intangible, right? But its intangibility is precisely evidence, not of its nowhereness, but of its everywhereness. Because that's the point that Benjamin wants to make about the police power, right? It's everywhere, yeah? So I wouldn't want to push that nowhereness too far, yeah? Now the question then is whether you're talking about the kind of invisibility of the monster of Leviathan or the monster of police or the monster of Behemoth or what?
I was talking mostly about Leviathan, but I guess more or less similar things.
About the monster, generally.
Yeah, primarily mine having okay. Leviathan.
Yeah, okay. But that's. But it is everywhere, right?
Yes, Leviathan, right? I mentioned that at the end.
Exactly. Came round to it, right? Yeah, no, that's right. I mean, you can't move for it, right? But often it feels like you are moving freely without it. Yeah? Whether that's also evidence of its the nowhere everywhereness of its monstrosity is another issue. I think. I think there is a question. There is a way you could take your comment and think about the way that the Leviathan deals with the monstrosity of something like the serial killer, or even just the criminal per se, or the monstrosity of criminality, which is to seek to render it not invisible, but take it out of immediate vision, but leave it visible enough so that people still know it's there. Right? That would be. Well, no, that would be the prison, right?
Just the textual elements for who governed in Leviathan. We have the expression sovereign representative. Yeah, chapter 30. Deals with the offices of sovereign representatives. And every man who is a part of government, of effective government, is not himself sovereign, but he takes part to sovereign power, and he is a sovereign representative. It's just a textual element.
Yeah, but that kind of needs updating to a certain extent, right, given the shift in technology from 1651 to 2014. There's a whole range of whatever you want to call them, police technologies, security technologies that don't rely on a claim about representatives, I think. But.
Thank you for your paper. Very, very insightful. I'm interested above all in the terminological question. For example, the fact that the verb to keep has this significance. Mm. Significance is these different meanings. No? I find it is very interesting. And also police. Police, as you shown, as in the history, no, in the history of the last 500 years, in Europe, different meanings. And as so far as I understood, you find that the original meaning, to keep order, no, to maintain the order, order in the sense also of cleaning and so on, is the core meaning of the police, of the job of the police. But and then you said that there is a difference between order and law. I'm interested in this difference. Yeah. Could you comment on this difference? Because what I ask myself is if there is a real difference, let's say in the state, no? The two different locations of these two notions, in the modern state, and if there is also maybe a dichotomy between these notions.
Mm. Yeah, let me just point out the thing about keeping is I had to write this in a hurry for various reasons, which I won't go into. So I was trying to piece together various thoughts that I'd had over the previous few months. And it was only really late in the writing of this that I had a sentence or a paragraph or something that I was trying to get in place. And I just had a thought about keeping the peace, and there was a comment that Hobbes had, and I can't remember which one it was, keeping X in Y, I don't even remember. And I suddenly thought, that's interesting, so I just did a quick search, really just kind of cruelly. I'd never noticed this before, but you know, it's remarkable how many times he uses this notion of keeping. Right? All of those things I mentioned were from Hobbes, you know, keeping in order, keeping in awe, keeping in place, it's quite remarkable. And I don't know if anyone's written about this. I think not. I mean I'm not a Hobbes scholar as such, so I don't know, right? But it struck me as quite remarkable, and then I made the connection with the keep, because I went to the Oxford English Dictionary thinking, what's going on with the keeping? I thought, okay, that's the castle, and then so various things came together. And then it just appears as a paragraph in here, but I did think there's probably a really interesting research project, right, around the whole notion of the keep or keeping in some way, and how it resonates through the history of political thought or history of ideas in general, or whatever.
I spoke a lot, it's you first. I spoke a lot.
Sorry, is this on this point, about keeping?
No, it's on a different point.
Okay. No. You want to cut in, or do you want to wait?
No.
Oh, sorry. I thought you were saying she wants to say something now.
No,
right?
No, no.
Okay.
No.
Okay. No, that's fine. Don't worry. Don't worry. Don't worry. That's my fault. It's my fault. Okay. So, in contrast to police, which I had thought about for many years, keeping I thought about for a few hours, and then that was it. But I do think there is something interesting there. The thing about police, law and order is that it's a huge issue, right? It's a huge problem. In particular, it's a huge problem for the way, you know, people on the left think about police and police powers and how to try and limit them or struggle against them or deal with them in some way, which is the kind of, you know, historically it's quite clear that the central category of police power is order, right? That's the issue, yeah? And you can kind of track the history of police powers, and in a sense, police institutions. I mean, the key shift for us is roundabout in England, 1829. But it's quite clear that a lot of other countries see that as a signal point, right? But it's roughly the very late 18th century into the early 19th century, yeah, where you get what is essentially a kind of a massive liberal rethinking of the police project, yeah, and you can track this, you know, for example, in Adam Smith's work, right, between the lectures on jurisprudence and the Wealth of Nations, where in the lectures of jurisprudence he talks about police powers in these general terms, right, and he even pauses actually on the question of cleanliness, and he wants to talk about police in terms of how he had got this idea in general, like good order, and he makes some comment along the lines of, you know, keeping street cleaning is too trifling an issue to be talked about in lectures on jurisprudence, something like that, right? And you can see he's hesitating, right? Between the lectures on jurisprudence and the Wealth of Nations, he goes to France, yeah? And he discovers, you know, the police, what is one of the main police functions in France at the time? It's, right, regulating the price of bread, right? Well, you know, regulating the price of bread, the price of grain, yeah? So bread, yeah, so this is a major police function, right? Okay, so this is a problem, right, for anyone who in the Wealth of Nations is going to argue for, you know, whatever you want to call it crudely, a minimalist state, a laissez-faire system, you know, the Wealth of Nations based on freedom of commerce and so forth, right? Yep. Okay, so what happens by the Wealth of Nations is that police has become a negative term. The only times he uses the police idea in the Wealth of Nations is negatively to talk about, you know, the problem over there, right? Okay. Yeah, from that point onwards, there's a kind of a massive liberal rethinking of the category of police. They can't do away with it, yeah? But they can't go with that, you know, long tradition associated with cameralism, police science, absolutism, yeah? And essentially, it gets narrowed down, right? So from roughly 1829, people stop talking about medical police, for example. Right? If you use the term now, people think you're crazy, right? What does that mean, right? But essentially, that's, you know, a large function of the health system is a kind of medical policing, right? Yeah. And part of its narrowing down, this is the point. I'm sorry, I feel like I'm getting off the point. It might feel like I'm getting off the point. I'm not. Part of its narrowing down was to impose a certain kind of ideological reading on the concept of police, which was the idea that the police exist to impose the law or to enforce the law. Yeah. Okay. Okay, order never disappears, right, which is why you get that almost hyphenated, I kind of hyphenated as a playful provocation to readers, right, which is to go law and order, hyphenated, law and order, right, as one, right, which is a way of trying to say, look, yes, you're absolutely right, we can't think about the police idea without thinking about law, you're right, but at the same time, you have to recognise that actually what's important is not law, is the order. Right? Now, if you look at the actual practices of police, if you mean by police the modern police in terms of the uniformed, the police force, yeah, what you find is that actually they're often not enforcing the law. Right? For a start, humongous amounts of time and humongous. Sorry, that's an English term. Huge amounts of time and energy, right, are expended by police officers doing nothing like enforcing the law, right? So various studies go, you know, you watch a police officer, you know, they can spend 7 years not arresting someone. What the fuck are they doing then? Right, well, what they're doing is, you know, I don't know, you know, a sheep wanders onto a motorway, right? Well, that's not against the law, right? There's no law against sheep wandering onto the motorway, but it's certainly disorderly, right? Yeah? So they're recreating, they're reimposing order, right? And that's generally what they do, apart from all sorts of other things like to do with, you know, giving you a crime number so you can claim on your insurance and so forth, right? Yeah, they know they're never going to catch the criminal that's broken into your house, but here's your number so you can claim your £3,000 insurance, etc., right? It's kind of policing as an insurance mechanism, yeah? Okay, but also, you know, what happens is you'll find that police officers are, on the record, there's a quote in the longer article, I didn't give the material here, but there's a quote, basically police officers say, look, if you expect us to follow the law, we'd never be able to do our job properly. Right, so what we have is a moral justification for, you know, working around the law, right? In effect, breaking the law, yeah. And this brings you down to another aspect of a huge aspect of police powers, which is the police, which is discretion, right? Police operate on the basis of discretion a large amount of the time, right? Yeah. So if you take, for example, the undercover police officers, this is an English case, it might not mean anything to people from abroad, but there's been a huge case recently where undercover police officers infiltrated environmental activist groups, yeah? Male officers, spent years in the groups, and as part of their cover, had sexual relations, long-term sexual relations with women in those environmentalist groups, right? Even having children with them, right? Now, if you read the Home Office report on this, which came out last year, you know, it's complicated, but essentially they go, look, this wasn't lawful, but it's quite clear that the officers, senior officers, knew what was going on, right? And it's quite clear that they knew what was going on because they knew, they understood or recognized that the police officer in question was exercising his discretion in order to manage his position, right? Because if you're in that environmental group for a long time, you're going to have sexual relations with people. Yeah? Okay? So discretion is a huge part of police power. Yeah? Secondly, what you find is if you look at the police laws themselves, you'll find that they've been shaped by police actions themselves, right? Kettling, yeah? The keeping of people in place. There we are again with the keeping, right? Always the keeping, right? The keeping of people in place in demonstrations. This is invented by the police forces, right? There's no law about kettling, yeah? But what happens is the police go, we've got, here's an idea, right? We can manage this situation by keeping these people in place for some time, right? How long can we keep them in place? No one knows. Well, what we'll do is we'll keep them here as long as we want to, and let's find out if it's legal afterwards. And lo and behold, you find that actually there's no law about it, so what we're going to have to do is write a law which tells us that that is now a legal procedure, right? The police invent laws. I mean, they don't invent laws, right? They invent practices, yeah, that then have to become legalized, right? So the executive power, the parliament here just follows police actions, right? Water cannon. What's the law on water cannon, right? This is, again, British cases. But, you know, there's been a debate in the last few months about whether the Metropolitan Police should have water cannon. Well, the water cannon don't appear in the Public Order Act 1986, right, which basically goes from, there's 30 stages in public order law. You're sorry you asked this question, aren't you? There's 30 stages in public order law, more or less starting with something like, move along now, there's nothing to see, right, to shooting people with live ammunition. Right? Okay, so riding at the crowd on mounted horses is around about number 24, something like that, right? Okay, but none of them are water cannon, right? Okay, but the police go, actually, do you know something? Water cannon would be a good idea, right? We've seen them do this abroad, right? In those foreign countries, right? But actually it looks like a good practice, yeah? So what are we going to do? We're going to introduce it, which is effectively what's happening, and you can bet your life that the law will change to reflect the police practice. Do you see what I'm saying? So, I've gone on a bit. The point is, if your starting point is law, right, you're always going to have a problem thinking critically about police powers, right? What you have to think about is police powers first, and their general concept of order, and their general concept of the thing that needs to be managed, which is the monster. So I haven't lost the track, right? And then you'll see that law follows, you know, law follows power here, right?
Now.
Yeah, well, now and historically.
Always so.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so you'll find huge in the cameralist literature. Sorry, I'll stop. I'll come back to it if there's an opportunity. Go on.
But we start. Yeah, go. With DNA. So first.
It's a small comment. Maybe to play with this trope of visibility and invisibility and. One of the things that intrigues me about Dexter is the Leviathan and the Eomorph are so thoroughly entangled in this persona. And and just as you think you've identified one, the other surfaces. But and I see that you're talking about them as how they're separate and entangled. Right. But the one thing I wanted to question or inch you maybe to think further about is I'm not sure it's entirely to say the Leviathan is hidden and the Eomorph is present. Is talking about the absent presence of racialized classes, right? So for the racialized classes, I would think that the behemoth in the figure of the police is fully present. It's not hidden. If you're anticipating being carded or stopped and searched or so maybe how the invisibility and visibility play is a question of positionality.
I don't know how directly you want to read this, but in terms of the racialized classes, the racialized classes are the behemoth.
Right, of course, they're constructed as the behemoth, right?
Yeah.
But I'm thinking, for instance, of the Rodney King trial, and really it was about who was the behemoth in that, in the plain frame by frame of who was beating who and what looked like resistance.
Yeah.
And
so
certainly they're constituted that way in a hegemonic discourse, but.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. No, that's fine. I agree. But interestingly, unfortunately for you, you prompted my. I'm going to carry on with the answer to that previous question, which is, what's interesting about the Rodney King trial here, right, here's another example, is that no assault took place, right? You know, they had the beat, was it 53 kicks or blows to the body of Rodney King, right, caught on camera, and it was the, discovered that no assault took place. So the police did not break the law, right? Do you see what I mean, right? They were, he was a problem, right, because he was disorderly. Or if anyone was breaking the law, he was. And that's the back to the racialized classes, right? The fact that his blackness is important there.
So we can't have time for all the questions. I'm happy to give up, but maybe
because we began with 5 minutes late.
Yeah,
so when I get 3 minutes again.
Your paper was very interesting. I'm asking if in I don't know if we can make a general theory about this, but. You are saying that in the struggle of classes, police is the state. The identify is totally identified with the state.
Yeah.
And so I'm asking in all the Marxist terms. So police is the repressive apparatus. Mm. And what about the ideological? You don't think a place for this?
Sure. Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
But these things are not distinct, right? You don't have to work with the idea of the police apparatus and the ideological apparatus. These things overlap. I mean, and actually, the whole logic of police, the whole concept of police, and law and order, is central to the ideological apparatus, which reinforces the idea that the police are somehow a general good, or there for the good of the general public, or there to keep the peace, or to ensure your security.
Because the ideological apparatus transform the monster, the many head monster, in something like labor forces.
Yeah, absolutely. No,
the police arrives when lacks the
No. The police is central. Historically, has always been central to the creation of, to the making of the working class. That has been its central function, right? To get people to labour. That's its core.
And what's interesting is the liberal theorists that I was talking about that tried to rethink the police concept in the late 18th and early 19th century. One of the reasons they could do that is because that's exactly what they said needed to happen, right? Which was actually, labour needed to be industrialised. So, classically in the case of England, Patrick Colquhoun, kind of great police theorist, basically said, right, we need a proper work. This is a really important point, right? Because this is about the monstrosity of the working class and the rebelliousness of the working class, right? Which is, how do you create the working class? How do you make the working class, right? Well, the most important thing you have to do is to take away any form of subsistence other than the wage, right? So what did Colquhoun say is, well, the first thing you have to do is you have to make sure that there are no mechanisms whereby workers can subsist outside of the wage, right? So the first police function is to take away, the English term is perks, perquisites, right? So, people picking up things on the job that they're not paying for, right? Or, if you prefer, picking up, wood in forests, fruit from trees, rabbits in woods, so forth, right?
This is the police before the police.
Yeah, but it's also the police that gets sustained in the late 18th and early 19th century. Yeah, it's all this. That this is, it's primitive accumulation, right?
Yes.
So maybe last question or note or discussion.
Sorry, I talked too long. I think Filippo's looking disgusted at me because I asked.
Okay, so
sorry.
I put an end.
Okay. Thanks.